books changing lives. How has writing books impacted you personally?
Well, first of all, the benefits that I've gained from writing is social capital. Okay. I have met all people of all calibers. I have met with ministers that I've never thought in life, even being in the profession. I never thought about that. I have received calls from big people that you cannot think about calling you.
Such as?
But you've called me. Like prime ministers. I've ever entered the prime minister's office. I've ever entered the president's office. I've ever entered the National Curriculum Development Center, sat with the director on the same table, discussed matters of importance.
National importance.
Yes, you get it.
Yes.
Which is not easy. I have gotten visas in my passport.
Oh, really?
For just writing books. I have been on different workshops in Turkey, Netherlands, where? You get it. I have moved just because of writing. Someone sees your content and says, can I connect you here? You try, you never know. But getting a visa becomes very easy for you because you have a reason. You are not going to seek for refugee. You are not going to seek for what? But you have a reason for going and you have a reason for coming back.
Yes.
Because of the responsibilities you have here and what you're serving to people. That one only.
Earlier, you mentioned someone in World Health Organization.
Yes.
Please tell us about that person.
Now, when you read my book, Addiction, The Silent Killer. Addiction is a mental disorder that can impact your life with no repair. If you don't go deep into understanding what it means. Okay. I had a driver in the house of one of my brothers. He got in challenges with his daughter who entered university in the first year and got her first relationship with a boyfriend. And then a boyfriend didn't marry her.
Okay.
And then that boyfriend of hers married her friend again.
Okay.
And left her. And this girl, since she was young, she thought, when you get your first man,
that's your husband.
Is the one you die with. She didn't have any experience that someone or people come into our lives with the reason and go. And we also have to let go, accept, and make
Move
life
on.
Continue.
Yes.
According to the story that I got from her, she told me she couldn't sleep thinking about that man or that boy, because I call them boys because they were still young, both of them, at 22 or 25. Of course, you're mature, but maturity is a combination of a number of things. For her, what she said that she couldn't sleep while thinking about the boyfriend who left her. And then she started by taking sleeping pills. You know them?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, sleeping pills in order for her to sleep and not think or even dream about the man or the boy, the boyfriend.
Insomnia.
Yes. So time came when she was entering her second year at the university when the sleeping pills are no longer working on her.
Oh.
And then she started taking those rapid drugs like Tramadol. Those heavy painkillers, because she was looking for relief over what she was going through, okay? That is the story how it started. So that is how she dragged herself slowly
into addiction
by to the extent of injecting herself. And now she got mental disorder.
Sorry.
So we used to suffer, or we suffered with that girl to bring her life in order. And I said, can't I write something about this demon? Because it's really a demon. It's a demon that you can get hooked onto when you don't know. But under a certain force that you can also not explain. As I've told you, relationship means having fun or happiness in any way. But see how it ends you into danger again.
Self-harm.
You get. Yes. This time it could be a friend or groups or excitement. Many young people or even adults experiment things that they have no knowledge about because of excitement. Because they have introduced something new to you and you want to know it and you test. And it becomes
curious.
Yes, with it. And then you find yourself into a situation that you never thought about. Then I said, can't I write something about this? I think I can. Then I started by doing research, internal research here. Went to Chisenyi zone, around Maki Ndiye, Murungu, went to Makerere, Chikoni, Chivuru, around Kampala suburbs. That's where I met underage children involving into a lot of things that the society could even not imagine. You find a boy child of 13, but it takes aviation fuel. And he tells you, when I inhale this, I can go to heaven and come back. I sometimes even speak to God. And he's okay, he's happy about that. And by the moment you enter into such people, you don't talk about the God you know. Because they don't understand him, the creator. For them, they know what they are using is their God.
Is the ticket to them?
That, yes. That is why the moment you find someone addicted into something or into something, and you start telling them about Bibles or God, you can even drag yourselves into a war. Because for them, they understand their addiction as their God. Someone can tell you, I cannot live if I've not injected myself. I cannot live if I have not taken beer or cat or marijuana or anything. I cannot happen. I mean, I cannot sleep. Yet it is in his mind that he can't sleep or he can't do anything else apart from using that to get the energy or the ability to do what or to perform activities normally. So that is how the disease penetrates or eats your brain, and your brain convinces your heart and the heart convinces the body. Katinogweram. And you become a slave to addiction. It's a journey. It may not happen today or tomorrow, but as you continue using what you use or whatever. And addiction is of different caliber, like technology,
okay.
A phone. You find someone spending the whole night on the phone and he sleeps at 5 in the morning or at 6. Or someone leaves the bed and go to work when he spend all his night or her night on phone.
True.
A car. We have seen many people shooting others to death.
Because of a car.
Because someone has scratched your car. That person is sick, but he doesn't know that he's sick. You get it? We have seen people suffocating with DNA. You take your children or your only one daughter you have in life, you're 50 years or 55 and above, for DNA, results comes back, the child is not yours, you start deteriorating. As if you are taking slimming pills. But when you're not, that is emotional addiction. You're sick. So addiction does not necessarily mean
substance.
Taking drugs or alcohol or what. You can be addicted to something that you don't know yourself that you can explain. That's why I came up with that book, to help the society understand what is your addiction. Today, as we are speaking now, in Uganda, 14% of Ugandan population have mental disorder issues. I saw it in newspapers last week. Have mental disorder. That implies, according to our population, every three people you meet, one has a problem that she doesn't know, or he doesn't know. And you also don't know. That's why these days people to burst into fight does not take minutes. You just step slightly on someone, instead of a sorry, he replies with a slap. So people are mentally disturbed because of the situation, circumstances like poverty. You get it. So a lot that I've disseminated in that book. So as I was on its journey of completion, I went to Commissioner Mental Health Control and the Minister of Health in Uganda. Called Madame Lukwata Sentongo Hafsa, and gave her my content to go through as a professional doctor and a mental health. She went through my book and advised me to take that book for evaluation in CDC or National Cultural and Development Center, because she told me, I don't know how you have gathered this information and the research and the stories. If they are real, we need to get their references and see these people, see how they are performing, what came after, up to death. So I benchmarked, gave all the statistics and references, and that is how my book went to National Cultural and Development Center.
Oh, wow.
And they evaluated it and approved it to be as a reference material for use in secondary schools and high institutions of learning. Because a commissioner told me it's a complete course. It's a complete course under mental health, not only in high institutions, I mean secondary schools, but up to PhD. This is beyond. So when I reached there, the book had to go under evaluation by professional cross-examiners who were there. It took like almost 6 months. They also asked me a lot of things, like references, examples of people with their consents and evidence. Then went to police also, to gather information in regards to cases, how they handle them in accordance with addiction, met several lawyers, and all that kind of people. And they have all put their forwards and
in the book.
In the book. That is how this book landed into the hands of mental health organizations and moved the world over. So right now, it has given me mileage whereby I won't tell the time, but I'm joining the British Council to go and study purposely writing. I mean, probably writing only for 9 months.
Congratulations.
So I'm very much sure when I come back, I'll be able to again continue
writing
as a profession. Because I started writing, one, to change, to see at least people change their perspective or the way how they see things. In my leisure, I used to write as leisure, but now it has touched me so much and made me a great man, which I think I can drop. I can't drop it now, and I'm sure I will die an author.
Okay. Usually people say scientists aren't very good with words.
Yeah.
How come you manage to be a storyteller?
Yeah, challenges. I started telling stories when I was 12 years of age, according to what I grew up seeing and going through.
Okay.
And by then, people used to ask me, how old are you? And I used to tell them, I am young, but challenges can make you grow old. Yeah. So even up now, I just imagine about something and I feel I should address about it. Mm. Yes.
How hard is it for you? Many writers suffer from writer's block.
Yeah.
I don't know, they lose their muse. And that excitement to write, the enthusiasm to write.
Yeah.
How easy has writing been, your writing journey? How hard, okay, tell me the process of your first book.
Writing
is
very...
How did you collect your thoughts
and
pen them down?
First of all, what disappoints all writers is taking your content that you think everything is right in the format you have put it and forward it into editors. And they show you all the rubbish you have done in your writings.
Okay.
It can lead you to go back tomorrow if you are not
strong
enough. More so, putting material in National Curriculum Development Center, it's not something easy. It's something that goes with patience and lower your expectations and temper on people, because you may abuse someone there when they tell you, because for them they are frank, they tell you the reality. You have mixed the English, British, America, what, Chinese, this is rubbish, go and do this. They can even cancel what you have done, put the X. But again, at the end of it all, you find a tick somewhere, you find the word good, then you find excellent. You go there with your English, about 400 pages, it comes back with only correct English of just 100 pages, and the kabook is like this. And you feel small. So all those are challenges, but challenges are learning lessons. I continued and went back with accepting the correction that I got. I added on, built stories. Then I mastered how everything should be, the order of writing.
Oh.
And that came by consulting those legendary authors. Actually, I want to thank Dr. Ashraf Simogiri. I met Dr. Ashraf in Mengo. I had a challenge in putting my work in order. For example, chapter one, what would be chapter one is chapter nine. You have made chapter 9 6. You get that order.
Okay.
Because when you starting to write, what you think is what you put where you have thought it from.
Yes.
You get it?
Yes.
Yet it doesn't work that way. You have to write or sketch, make your whatever concept or script, and then sit down and put it in order. That one, it's also calling. Sometimes in my books, selecting the titles, those covers, and the taglines, it is a calling. For me, I just sleep after organizing my work, and I find myself waking up in the middle of the night.
With a title?
Yes, something telling me, join this. that can interest someone's mind and attract the eyes. Because my books, when they are on the display, someone buys just after that attraction or what is seeing. And how you organize your blurb or the backside, because a good reader reads the title and then the blurb. It is very, very important to focus on it and to show authentic writer. So that is how I started, and all those embarrassments and whatever, I had to put them aside. Because my dream was to become a great author and at least put some material in Uganda's heritage and the world, which I have done.
Okay. Congratulations, Ugandans.
Thank you. Yes, and the certificates are there
from
National Curriculum Development Center. So it is not easy. Writing takes time that needs commitment. For example, you see those books as simple materials, but you may find each of them taking you 2 years to produce. Like the Independent Life and the Independent Life Amid Its Crisis. That book took over 6 years when I was still organizing it, being that I was new in the system of writing, the industry, and gathering all this the long stories I had behind me. And the money. Producing one copy of a book or an edition cost you between 30 million to 60 million. No one can publish one copy of a book.
True.
Starts from 1,000. 1,000 copies and above. And the more the copies are less, the more expensive they become. Because there are a lot of things that are involved in printing books, plates, what, a lot of things. And buying those templates only is a lot of money. Like, for example, when you're just starting, it will need you, some templates starts at 10 million, 8 million to buy it for yourself, and it stays there in a printer. So it is something, when it's hard, sounds simple, but many people have been jumping out of it just because of that. But we would have had a number of authors in the country. But because it involves a lot of things and finance, you find that many people have been jumping out of it, and commitment.
True.
It's sacrifice. Like Addiction, The Silent Killer. That book took me 2 years to pen it down. But doing research with the references and the statistics of Uganda, East Africa, Africa, and the world at large. So it is not something that is simple.
It's
and these
work.
Days, it is hard work that needs you to put in all your potential and effort if you are to master it and benefit or fulfill your dreams. It's not a journey of roses. It's
okay.
A bumpy road with rocks.
Thorns.
And all that kind of stuff, potholes, bigger than the ones we have in Kampala.
It's impossible. You've written about health and said social life.
Yeah.
Have you written anything on engineering?
Yes, I have two
editions
about engineering. Which are yet to be out. But of course, professional books again take
long.
A lot and long because you plan for generations and generations.
Peer reviews.
Yes. Because National Cultural Development Center, they don't approve a material that will set a precedent and damage the future of the country. They have to be so sure, because the moment you take your material there, you have also given them a task of going back to study again. So that day, disseminate what you have brought to them.
True.
For generations also. So that is where the stage we are now. But I've come up with a very interesting and good engineering books for starters.
Okay.
And skills.
Okay.
Of which I'm very much sure the students and the general public will enjoy it, because these books are going to be helping people to start or supervise your project when you know something. Than today, whereby someone gives you whereby today someone gives you a job, but whatever you tell him or her is what she or he buys, is what he gives you. But if these books tells you exactly the weight of the building, how you share the spacing and all that kind of stuff, you get to know. You go read the book, at least not to be driven just
by
like a blind person. Yes. So I am opening the public's eyes to see these things, that they can be manageable. You may not be an engineer, but to avoid being cheated, you have to be part of the construction of your house or project.
Well, that's a very noble thing.
Yeah.
Because usually they lie to us, well knowing that we don't have a clue.
Exactly.
Okay.
I have put books to order, and anytime they will be out. And I have written about marriage due to the increasing divorce rate and prostitution in the world. People should know, if I do this, am I really in the Bible track or Quran? Or whenever, whatever you believe in, is it the right thing to do?
Okay.
What causes marriage not to stay these days? What is really the problem?
Okay.
Then I have written about politics. There is a book called The Polite Nation. I have another book called The True and Honest Politician.
Where you to find that one?
They are there.
Okay.
Very many. One of my friend, a politician, read it and told me, well, I think you wrote about me. This book talks about me on the 70%. I was like, you know, those are the tricks you trick people to get votes. So people should know that if someone comes and tells us he's going to construct for us boreholes and he goes for 5 years, then after 5 years he comes with the pipes. And he wants 5 years more to come, then he will come with a pump. You have to know.
Okay.
What these people, what this person is all about. It's not all about working for us, but is tricking us or using us as his stepping stones or steps to fulfill his ambitions.
True.
Not us. So I have done that.
Okay.
But there's some of the books, politicians are against them.
Of course.
Otherwise, there are not many. I write and put them there.
Okay.
So whoever gets to know there is a good book here, they've been finding them on the market.
Okay.
Yes.
But I've been curious throughout this interview. Your other name is Waswa.
Yeah.
Where is Kato?
Yeah, Kato is in the United States.
Okay.
He's a pilot. He works with a... He works with a Bow, is it?
Boeing?
No. There is a company that he works with. I've forgotten it, has gone out of my head. This is a guy who was very stubborn as we were growing.
Okay.
And yesterday I spoke to him, he told me he's in Qatar, that he will be going back.
Okay.
He dropped out of school in senior four. And then tried to do something, ended in senior five. But he also found or discovered his inability to do something and joined a certain big company out there and continued studying when he's working. But now he's doing well, even more than me who finished the university. So maybe he used the shortcuts. But So you have to look for your destiny. Mm. The way you benchmark for your destiny also matters a lot. But he found also his potential and is now flying plane.
Oh, so yeah. He wasn't with you during your hustle?
We were together. We were
together. Working together.
Yeah, we just found ourselves in the corner where we should at least split ourselves and look for a living.
Thank you, Ivan. That's all we had for today. See you again next week, same time on People and Stories.